on to our next speaker.
Good morning, one and all. Today, I would like to give you an update about biomarkers in acute kidney injury. What is a biomarker? It's a distinctive biological or biologically derived indicator of a process, event, or a condition. So, why do we need for a biomarker now? So, to know that, I would like to give you a few details about AKI. Acute kidney injury is a very common complication, occurs in around 7 to 8% of hospitalized patients, and up to around 50% of a critically ill patients carry a very high mortality. 1/3 of hospital-acquired AKI cases are avoidable. More than half are subjected to inadequate risk assessment. And it claims about 2 million lives a year all over the world. And everything is at least 2 to 3 times worse, including length of stay, hospital cost, 30-day readmissions, and hospital mortality. So, AKI mortality and morbidity is high. See here, those without AKI, it's only 0.6. With the increasing the severity of AKI, the mortality has gone to a large extent. In-hospital mortality and even 90-day mortality is also very high. And it seems it's more serious than a heart attack. It is twice as deadly. It is because there's a lot of improvement in MI treatment and mortality due to MI has come down to a significant extent in the last few decades. Unlike in AKI, where there is no much improvement in even early diagnosis or in therapy, and it's largely remain untouched and it is still very high. So, where is the problem here? As you know, now all the definitions of AKI includes either serum creatinine or urine output. Both parameters are not a very sensitive one. Serum creatinine is a widely available marker for in estimating the kidney function and to define the AKI. But in fact, the serum creatinine is an insensitive and unreliable indicator of acute kidney injury. Because, you know, it is a functional marker. When the structural damage is significant enough that it affects the more than 50% of the kidney function, then only it starts rising. So it's a very, very insensitive and late marker for kidney injury. So we would like to target when we will be able to detect the injury very early, when we will be able to detect the kidney structural injury early, before it affects the function, right? So, and another thing is, the serum creatinine reflects the underlying GFR only when the steady state is reached. It usually takes 24 to 48 hours to reach that steady state. And it is definitely a better marker when compared to AKI in CKDs, where the renal function changes over a long time. But in AKI, the GFR is sometimes changes very rapidly. In few hours, also, there may be rapid changes. But in such conditions, it doesn't actually reflect that real-time GFR. This is another fallacy about serum creatinine. And, you know, it is influenced by other non-renal factors, like gender, muscle mass, and other diseases, including malnutrition also. So, we need to have a biomarker so that we could detect the injury before it affects the function, so that we can detect early. So if you treat them in a phase where it is reversible, so it may improve the outcomes of the AKI. So ideal biomarker should be like this. It should be kidney specific. It has to differentiate pre-renal, intrinsic, and post-renal from each other. It has to detect the AKI early. And it has to identify the cause of the kidney injury, and it has to localize the sites, and it has to give information about the pathology. It should be easily, reliably, and promptly, non-invasively measurable. It should be stable in its matrix, inexpensive to measure. Do we have that? I don't know. Even in near future also, we may not get such an ideal biomarker. So there is a long list of biomarkers I think more than 300, but it's impossible to enlist even. So I would like to focus on a few and important biomarkers as of today. Of those, neutrophil gelatinase associated lipocalin, called as NGAL, it's extensively studied in, I think, more than 2,500 studies are there, and followed by interleukin 18, kidney injury molecule KIM1, cystatin C, and then liver type fatty acid binding protein, and then very off late for the past 3 years, the latest biomarkers like urinary insulin like growth factor binding protein 7, IGF-BP7, tissue inhibitor of metalloproteinase 2, TEMP2. Broadly divided into, for the sake of convenience, inflammatory biomarkers, NGAL and IL-18, cell injury related, KIM1 and LFAB, cell cycle biomarkers, urine TEMP2 and IGF-BP7. So let us give you an idea about NGAL. It's a 25 kilo Dalton protein of the lipocalin family, a biomarker for ischemic injury, and it is significantly increased in inflammatory states where there is an injury. It is studied extensively in the following settings: in ischemic or septic ATN, post-transplant states where it can be helpful in detecting DGF, delayed graft function early, and in those patients following bypass surgery, and in conditions of IV contrast administration. So here we have two pools. This NGAL in serum is derived from neutrophils and other organs like liver and lung. And a small amount is filtered, and that is completely reabsorbed through the megaline in tubules. The urinary pool is the another pool where it gets released, especially when there is an injury only. So serum NGAL, the source is different. Urine NGAL, is the source is different. So it is thought to reduce the injury by inhibiting the apoptosis and by increasing the normal proliferation of kidney tubule cells. So remember that it's a renoprotective. And more specifically, it regulates the heme oxygenase and thereby preserving the N-cathetrin in proximal tubule, subsequently inhibiting the cell death. So it's tested in multiple studies, and I would like to mention one very important one, a large multi-center study, a prospective one, involving many centers, more than 1,200 patients. It's a translational research investigating biomarker endpoints in AKI study, TRIBE AKI. They tested about plasma NGAL and urine IL-18. It helps in improving the risk stratification and identify patients at higher risk for progression of AKI and worse patient outcomes. So it may aid in diagnosis of early ATN, and it also helps in differentiating it from pre-renal disease. So Paragas in 2011 studied in a mouse showed that it is useful in differentiating pre-renal from ATN. And in fact, Biopato Diagnostics launched this test in Europe in January 2011. It is estimated as a commercial, in a commercial way, by means of either particle enhanced turbidometric immunoassay or by ELISA. See, this is how this is elevated. And I would like to tell you one point here. This CABG is a very good optimal model of AKI, to study AKI, because the timing of injury we know exactly. So, so far the best available human model for AKI is post-CBG. So where, see the elevation, it rises very early, almost peaks in less than six hours in those with AKI. In the same way, see the serum creatinine. Compare it this with that, it rises in the 6 hours, but serum creatinine, it takes a lot of time, it rises only after 48 hours. So that's why I'll tell you, this is a very early and sensitive marker in predicting the risk of AKI. This is another study showing the same. Those with AKI, it rises early. Let us have a look here. See, this line is about IL-18, and this is about NGAL, this green one about LFAB. These are pink and blue lines are about serum cystatin and creatinine C. So the markers that rise very early are, one is NGAL and another one is LFAB. So I already told you it's helpful in, because it detects the AKI very early. It's helpful in intensive care unit, emergency rooms, and CABG, post-renal transplant, and in IV contrast agents when assessing nephrotoxicity. Next come to another marker, IL-18, interleukin-18. It's also a biomarker for injury. It is formed in the proximal tubules. It can be detected in urine when there is an injury. And it is significantly elevated in patients with ATN. It actually is a pro-inflammatory. It actually contributes to renal injury, unlike the previous one. It is a renoprotective. This IL-18 is a pro-inflammatory. See here, when there is any bacterial products, it stimulates the TLR4 receptors and activates the inflammasome. There, pro-caspase is cleavage to caspase 1, which cleaves pro-IL-18 to IL-18. So when there is an injury, it gets released into the urine in large amounts and contributes further injury. So this is how it rises, especially when there is an ATN. So it's studied in renal transplant recipients where the higher levels are are reflective of delayed graft function, and another one, ischemia reperfusion injury, another drug toxicity studies. So you can use the NGAL and IL-18 as a sequential markers also, because this NGAL peaks in the first 2 hours, followed by IL-18, which peaks at 12th hour. A potential limitation for these is, it's like a more generalized marker of inflammation rather than a specific marker of AKI, especially when there is a background comorbid factors. The another molecule is a kidney injury molecule called as KIM-1. It is again renoprotective, unlike the IL-18. It's a type 1 transmembrane protein having an extracellular mucin and immunoglobulin domains. It's upregulated in ischemic injury in proximal tubules. And now it can be readily detected by a new KIM-1 urinary dipstick. So here, normally, these green ones are the KIM-1 molecule. Normally, it helps the tubules by clearing the apoptotic cell debris and other necrotic debris. But when there is an injury, a huge amount will get released, and it gets released in the urine. Thereby, we can detect the peak, and it helps by remodeling the kidney injury. So it's a renoprotective by clearing the apoptotic or necrotic debris. It has got a role in determining the risk for development of AKI. There is a study in 2010 that it was able to predict the future development of stage 1 and stage 3 AKI along with the alpha-glutathionase transferase enzyme. I also told you it may play in a role in renal remodeling after AKI, so that it may be a target for pharmacological intervention too. Coming to the cystatin C, it's again, unlike all the previous biomarkers, it's again a functional marker like a serum creatinine. It's not a marker for kidney injury. It's a cystine protease inhibitor found in all nucleated cells, freely filtered, and not protein bound, not normally secreted in urine. It competes with the albumin for endocytic reabsorption, but its analysis is still affected by diabetes, steroids, hyperthyroidism, where there is an elevated bilirubin and inflammation. So another one is liver type fatty acid binding protein. It's also predominantly localized in proximal tubules. It's also useful in cardiac surgeries in renal transplant recipients. This LFAB is the one, yellow one. This usually binds to the albumin, free fatty acids, and that carries the free fatty acids to the mitochondria and lysosomes. when there is an injury, it binds to the free oxygen radicals and it gets released in the urine. Thereby, it attenuates the renal injury by means of its antioxidant properties. So it was also studied extensively. So it is approved as a diagnostic test for AKA in Japan. So as an individual biomarker, all have not having a very good sensitivity. So biomarker combinations are tested in TRIBE AKA study. There in adults, this three-way combination, this ROC curve will give you the better information. If it is more than 0.75, that's a good one. So these three combinations are helpful. In children, even two are better than the any single one. So do you have a troponin-like in kidney? See the time period here. There's a lot of improvement in the diagnostic aspects of acute coronary syndrome, unlike in AKI. So there is a chance. The study came in 2013. It's a big study where 304 biomarkers were identified. Of that, two markers were chosen. That's about this. This is the structural aspects of cell markers. This is the cell cycle of, this is where it acts. These are the markers of cell cycle injury, where it will induces the arrest in the G1 phase. So this is further, these two markers were further tested in Sapphire study, where the combination of these two appears to be far better than the existing biomarkers. Here AUC curve is more than 0.75 and it is top in the list. So those two were chosen. So again, there is no much clarity about KIM1 here. This is about NGAL, but see the product, this one. This is called cell cycle arrest biomarkers. So one threshold is given to have a high sensitivity, like 0.3. The another threshold more than 0.2 is given to have a high specificity. So US FDA approved this product in September 2004 to determine whether certain critically ill patient, hospitalized patients are at risk of developing moderate to severe acute AKA in the 12 hours after testing. This is further tested in other studies, OPAL and TOPAZ. In all the three studies, they consistently proved to be a better marker. So this is called as NephroCheck test. It will test the product of TIM2 and IGF-BP7 in human urine. 0.3 is for higher sensitivity. 2 cutoff is for higher specificity. This is a beautiful slide to give you an idea about how these biomarkers are playing in different stages of AKI. In the initiation phase, see the early peak. The red one is a plasma NGAL that peaks early than anyone else. Then this one is LFAB, then urine NGAL, followed by the green one is urine IL-18. Followed by the blue one is KIM1. So early peak is by NGAL and LFAB, followed by IL-18, followed by KIM1. So this is a study came in January 2015, trying to integrate these latest biomarkers into the existing model of
two
AKI.
Two more minutes left.
A little concentrate about this slide. Here, how these biomarkers are helpful throughout in AKI. So, you know, initiation where the injury is started, in extension further injury and further loss in GFR, where, as I told you, this IL-18 as a contributor for renal injury will be elevated and it really contributes to some injury. Apart from that, renal intrarenal RAS is activated. That's also one of the contributors to the renal injury. So, in NGAL and LFAB, will be or renoprotective by helping the by means of their anti-apoptotic and antioxidant properties. So in extension phase, elevated IL-18 reflects that the injury is ongoing. After that, in the later phase, in maintenance and repair phase, the Skim1 and NGAL helping in recovery by means of their anti-apoptotic and by clearing the debris by means of its Skim1 molecule. Once in the late phase, the persistence of urine angiotensinogen will give you an idea about that patients are at a high risk for CKD progression, because it's a marker of intrarenal RAS activation. So it gives you a prognostic information to you that patient is going to land in trouble. The persistence of the early markers Skim1 and NGAL will also give you an idea that this patient is going to give you trouble and this patient is going to land up in ESRD or to CKD. As you know, this is very common and carries very high mortality. The mortality and morbidity remains unchanged over the last many years, as it's diagnosed very late. But biomarkers are coming in the way. They're helpful, and now and then they're getting tested, some in Japan, some in Europe, some are given approval in US. And even in India, NGAL can be estimated. It costs you around 2,800 to 3,000. And urine NGAL will give a good information about diagnosis. Urine angiotensin will give an information about the prognosis. And cell cycle arrest biomarkers, though not behave like a troponin for ACS, are giving a promising results, but yet to be validated in further large studies. Thank you all.
Thank you, Sunil. This was a wonderful presentation. You've made such a complicated topic so simple in front of us. Can I ask you one question on this? How do you foresee these biomarkers helping an emergency physician or intensivist in picking up these kidney injuries early in the phase of illness? And what kind of management strategies you foresee that we will be changing or implementing once we identify this injury? In terms of how will it help us change the management of the patient in future?
Good question. See, here, I told you the existing marker for estimating the kidney function is only serum creatinine and urine output. You know, urine output is not a perfect and specific marker for this. So some 30 to 40% can be oliguric in a severe AKA also. And serum creatinine, for various reasons I mentioned, it's not a sensitive one, especially in AKI. So if you can identify the injury when it is occurring, especially in a stage of structural damage, very early in the damage, so that you could modify the antibiotics, and we could manage the hemodynamics, and if you have so far we don't have any treatment, a specific particular treatment that can arrest this kidney injury, even though we could detect them in the early process. But there is a possibility that I highlighted that the cell cycle arrest markers, where there's a beautiful concept that these markers, the cells will go into a transient arrest during injury as a protective phenomenon in order to not to allow the injured DNA into the cell division. But at the same time, this cell cycle in arrest phase, in G1 phase, must be for transient period of time. If it stays in for long period of time, again, that may lead to a fibrotic type phenotype, and it may lead to a further injury and CKD. So if you can manipulate that arrest phase, and if you can induce in a timely way, and if you can get out of that in a timely fashion, if you can find a molecule in such a way, I think it will be a beautiful one to tackle the ATN like in ACS. But right now we don't have a promising biomarker in that field, but studies are going on, And as per the existing knowledge, for the question Dr. Pankaj Arora asked, see, as of now, if you could use the NGAL in our emergency settings so that we could identify that who are in pre-renal state, who are in ATN state. Sometimes you may have the creatinine 1.5. Actually, I have encountered this in a post-operative setting. I was called on emergency basis and the patient was very sick and severe pulmonary edema and his serum creatinine is only 1.5. That's it. And the operation is over and he's not putting out any urine and many fluids were into it and he went into pulmonary edema. So I had to dialyze him because of acute pulmonary edema. Because they didn't have an idea patient was in ATN or in pre-renal state. I think many a times patients were saved because of the extensive hydration perioperatively. I think most probably many a times, but few times you may land up in these complications. So if you could employ in such a clinical condition biomarkers like these, so we can see that it's only a pre-renal state, we can confidently manipulate the hemodynamics without getting into a complications.
Thank you very much.
I think I have given